And then we export inflation through the U.S. dollar being the reserve currency of the world. And we have a great war machine. So, I mean, we export a lot of debt and death.
A new silver company for investors, with Keith Neumeyer agreeing to become a major shareholder. Luke Norman, co-founder of Gold Standard Ventures, is the new chairman. And the company has acquired three former First Majestic silver properties. To learn more about this must-own silver stock, go to futuremoneytrends.com/silver1. That's futuremoneytrends.com/silver1. Hello, everyone, and welcome into CrushTheStreet.com. I'm Kenneth Amaduri, and I'm joined today with David Morgan of TheMorganReport.com. I've known David now for a number of years, going back to, you know, my early days in the newsletter world. I really looked up to him. I still do. And, you know, I'm very honored to be speaking with him today, especially at the start of this year, to get his thoughts on what are going on in the metals and the market as a whole. And, you know, he was one of the ones that suspected, you know, precious metals to turn down after a really spectacular start in 2016 in the summer. He was suspecting that we would see the pullback. And here we are. You know, metals have pulled down, and they're starting to trend up here. We're having a good little start to 2017, but I want to get his thoughts on that. And he's got an interesting, very interesting speculation play for all of his members that we're going to hear a little bit about towards the end of this interview. But first of all, David, thanks for joining me today.
Well, thank you for the kind words and the introduction. I hope I can live up to it.
You always do, sir. You know, 2017 has not started off in the panic the way 2016 did. You know, if you recall, we had the interest rate hike and the news from China, markets melting down across the world. It seems like there's a little more optimism in the air. Precious metals are up, so is oil, and the Dow Jones once again, you know, on the verge of breaking 20,000. What do you make of this?
Well, it's a shift in psychology, really. I mean, if you know, as much as I study the stock market and continue to and study all markets, you know, one of the biggest errors I made as a very young guy was, you know, having a strong math background and relying too much on numbers, you know, and I'm still a numbers guy. I mean, I want to make sure that, you know, the investments that we put in the Morgan Report are, you know, especially in the top and mid tier, you know, make sense numerically. However, the markets are really psychological, and it has a lot to do with how people feel. And so the feeling is now, basis Trump or not, the market is signaling, and there's different whys. I think one of the big whys is because Trump is elected, but I think there's other reasons. And they play into this good feeling, the Dow's gonna go over 20,000, you know, the metals, commodities look good. If you looked at the news feeds yesterday, and I certainly can't read them all, but I looked at your Reuters and BMO, and both of them were positive. They're looking positively for the economy. China came out with numbers that indicated that they're doing better than they have in quite some time. That kind of gave the whole market a lift. And the commodity sector and both these mainstream financial channels talked about stronger commodity markets. You look at the other white metals, platinum, palladium, and they both had two really strong days at the beginning of this year. Obviously, we're just a few days in. And that's a trade I used to make almost every year. I didn't do it this year, and I'm kind of mad at myself. Palladium is such a thin market, but both of the white metals usually get a pretty good run into January. And so far, so good. As we're doing the interview, Kenneth, we're looking at everybody's up, gold, silver, platinum, and palladium. Those first three are up less than 1%, and palladium is up about 4.5%. Anyway, the point I'm making is that most of the mainstream is looking for a more positive outlook across the board, commodities, stocks. Not much is said about the bond market. I finally am convinced that the top of the bond market is in, and we're going to see higher interest rates and lower bond prices from here on out for quite some time.
What is that? And that was actually one of the questions I had for you, is interest rates. And if interest rates go up to a certain degree, at what point does it compete with stocks and put major downward pressure on the overall stock market?
Yeah, that's actually an easy question to answer if you understand, you know, the dynamics of interest rates. So if, you know, one of the big bugaboos out there that's misunderstood by a lot of people is, you know, higher interest rates are bad for gold. Higher real interest rates are bad for gold. So let me illustrate. If you go back to the major upleg in gold and silver, 1979 through January 1980, what you saw was the published CPI was at 13% inflation. Mm. So when Volcker put interest rates to like 20%, that was a real rate of 7%. Why? Because 20 minus the 13 that the government admitted gives you 7. So you have 7% real interest rates. That's what you're really getting, because 13% of that 20% is eaten up by inflation. So until you get to a positive real interest rate, it has no effect on gold. In fact, gold goes up as interest rates come up until it hits that point or beyond that point where you get a real return. So that's something that most people just don't understand, because most people really don't get what inflation means and how insidious it is. You know, it's in fact, some people, even in, I wouldn't say that they're true Austrians, but the Austrian persuasion think, well, you know, 2% inflation is okay. No, you don't want any inflation. In fact, in a stable monetary system where you have an honest-based system, at least this is what the past shows us, you get a gentle deflation, which is not bad. And this is actually how the markets really work, which means that your iPhone 7 is better than your iPhone 5, and it costs you less. That's an increase in productivity. It's an increase of the product itself, and it's deflationary because it costs you less in US dollars or Federal Reserve notes than it did, let's say, 5 years earlier.
Sure.
And that's a general trend, because human nature and the markets itself generally improve. And they squeeze the margin, meaning they give you a better product at a lower cost. So if you have a stable monetary system, you actually have a higher standard of living generally year over year. And that's what, you know, we all want. We all want to have, you know, a high lifestyle. And those, that, you know, concept means different things to different people. And I think we can talk about that at the end of the show. But so that's the idea. It's a real interest rate. That's sure. What you have to be with.
Well, and to be fair, a lot of the inflation that we've seen has been exported overseas. And the other countries have experienced the brunt end of U.S. inflation. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, we export a lot of entertainment, you know, movies, Hollywood and others. And then we export inflation through the U.S. dollar being the reserve currency of the world. And we have a great war machine. So, I mean, we export a lot of debt and death. And I mean, I hate to be so blunt, but if you really are objective and you're really truthful with yourself and you look out and see what really is rather than what you want it to be, what you see is this death and debt paradigm that Chris Duane talks about all the time, and he's right. This is really the exports, and this is a very sad state of affairs. What we really want is what the liberals always talk about. You know, we want to respect everyone, you know, be tolerant, and we want diversity. Well, there's no better diversity than having a nation state have its own culture. I mean, this idea that we need a new world order and we put everybody in a blender and we stir it up and everybody comes out the same. I mean, how boring is that? I mean, it's much more interesting world to have, you know, nation states that have their own culture, or within those states have a culture. And so, you know, that's my perspective. You don't have to agree with it, but I kind of like to flip it back on the liberals, what's called liberals today, because, you know, if you really want diversity, then leave these, then let's not have a new world order. Let's let people be themselves. Let's let them determine their own future. Let's let them have their own culture. Let's let them have their own monetary system if they care to. But the reality is that the biggest problems in the war effort, I'll call it, has to do primarily with resources and not fitting into the Anglo-American Empire's banking system.
Well, speaking of the establishment, and you know, let's talk about the outsider coming in here for a brief moment. The establishment is in disarray. We're seeing that right now. Democrats, at least, are frantically trying to come up with some reason to disparage the Trump victory, and they keep coming up short. You know, Julian Assange, in a major interview with Sean Hannity, has denied having any contacts with Russian sources. And of course, you know, we had the recount, the Electoral College. You know, it's the fault of the Electoral College for why Donald Trump became elected. You know, the Russian hacking. And then, you know, if we go back early this year, you know, Brexit and so forth. So the establishment is really losing ground here. And I want to get your thoughts on that. And then actually transition to the medals. I mean, are we going to see a loss of control that the establishment has over the medals going forward here?
Okay, well, you gave me two questions. On the first one, you know, what's going on with, you know, blaming Russia for everything? I mean, really, it's, you know, I'll just spit it out because, you know, I can be fairly aggressive at times. If you really, I've thought about it. Here's my thoughts. Look, we've got the NSA, right? Well, the National Security Association or Advisory, whatever it's called, the NSA, the big spy agency, basically listens to every frickin' phone call, every email. In other words, they gather in electronic intelligence, communications intelligence, and signal intelligence across the globe. Purportedly, they get every frickin' piece of information that exists. Now, they're the establishment. So if they really were on top of their game and we had an honest political class, they come right out and say, hey, we're the NSA, and here's where it came from. They know. They get all the info.
That's right.
But do they come out and say, oh, we're the NSA, and it came directly from here? It was leaked by an insider at the CIA to WikiLeaks. He is no longer in our club. He's been booted out, and we're after him, or whatever. I mean, I made up that part just to get you to think. But, I mean, the NSA could easily come out and say, well, it came from here. They know. But do they say anything? Oh, no, 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 no. They're in the background. So now they're out there. Actually, they're trying, you know, in my view, manipulate, again, psychology, public opinion, what really drives everything. And people are emotional beings. I mean, you know, we use an intellect, but people aren't taught logic. They're not taught critical thinking. They're not taught to really evaluate things objectively. And we all have our biases. I'll admit most of mine, and at least I can, the ones I can see. And this is the problem. That, you know, oh, it didn't feel good, or it doesn't feel right. Well, you know what? We have a plethora of emotions, and you got to deal with all of them in an adult way once you reach adulthood, which is an achievement that very few in this country achieve, in my opinion. So, back to the second question on the medals.
Well, before we'll get to that in a second here. So on that, I actually heard, you know, and I was thinking about this. Hillary Clinton spent $1.5-2 billion on her campaign. But going back to the fact that they're in such disarray, I mean, they thought they were going to win. If they thought they were going to lose, I mean, maybe they would have spent a lot more money. And, you know, and we didn't see that, though. And that's where, to me, it seems like there's just a dysfunction in the establishment, and the fact that we saw Donald Trump rise up. I mean, it's so powerful, regardless of, you know, you fully support him or whatever. The fact, what he means to the current situation is very powerful, and that the sources such as WikiLeaks and the internet are really making it very difficult for the establishment to do what they do. Even Bitcoin. I mean, the Bitcoin rise, an unmanipulated free market currency doing what it's doing is making a huge statement right now. And I don't know how much, I don't know what the world is going to look like in 5-10 years. And I just think changes are happening so fast.
Absolutely. I mean, the internet is more powerful than the Gutenberg press, in my opinion. I said that very early on when the internet became more available to the average person. And that's been a long time ago. And this free market of ideas is extremely profound. And nothing is more profound than the truth spoken at the right time, which is basically what Trump did. I'm not a big Trump thumper, believe me. But the establishment had such a difficult time packaging something that was so inconsistent. that was flip-flopping would say something at one rally and something contradictory to that at another rally, trying to be something, no consistency, no truth, no credibility, and all those things played into, so the establishment had a very hard time packaging that. And on the other side, you had basically an independent. You had somebody that was not really beholden to the political class at all. And they came up, and yeah, they shot off the cuff, and yeah, they probably said things that upset people, but at least you knew you were getting something sincere, something truthful. At least it came across that way. Again, we're going back to perception and emotion and how people felt about it. Mm-hmm. But it resonated with enough people that a lot of people got off their butts and never voted in a long time and got out there and voted. Mm-hmm. So this is something that resonates with people. You know, the time has come to speak the truth clearly and precisely. And the truth is, we're broke. Most other nations are broke. And we got a real mess on our hands on a physical economy basis because we're producing stuff but not enough of what we really need. And the flow rate, the velocity of money has come to a very low ebb. And there is one way to get it going again, and that's fiscal policy, which Trump will implement, which means direct government payment into the back pockets of the workers, the workers that are working on government programs, which means fixing the infrastructure. That won't fix the problem, but it will fix the psychology for a while. Excuse me. So you'll see a kind of a Trump euphoria. I think that could last, you know, anywhere from 6 months to a year and a half. I don't want to go to a year and a half. But the reality of the big monster in the background of the debt pyramid is still there. And sure, how that's addressed or overcome, I don't think it can be overcome. And mathematically, it's impossible to overcome it. But you can still feel good about we're making progress for, you know, several months.
Sure. Well, you know, the headlines he's making with, you know, Ford keeping their plants here and Carrier and these Japanese companies coming in and investing. I mean, if he keeps, you know, making headlines on a weekly basis on all these companies that want to invest in the country, I mean, that's really going to make people feel great about where the country's going, regardless of the numbers, because you know how people think. Most people are so detached from a $20 trillion debt and all the obligations that the government has. And maybe even the politicians are too. I mean, you know, it's kind of blind faith. And what other options do you have other than to move forward? But David, here, let's get into precious metals here. On that note, is the establishment going to lose control over precious metals? Will the internet exposure of the fraud that is taking place and just the fact that people might be waking up? I mean, are we going to see some shakeups with the prices of gold and silver going forward here?
Quite possibly. I mean, I've said pretty much from day one that there will be a day, to quote Jim Popava, there'll be a day like no other day, where you will see the physical market take over the metals pricing. And we've already seen it a couple times in silver. Saw it during the 2008 crisis, but that was not silver, the commodity, the 1,000-ounce bars on the COMEX. That was silver in the retail market, which was, you know, coins, small bars, and 100-ounce bars. But still, it did take place. But two things. Number one is a direct observable thing, and that is that Deutsche Bank admitted to manipulation of the market. And to get a lower fine, they also outed other banks like HSBC and Scotia and others. And so this is a huge thing. The whole time that, and I'll give, I think Ted Butler deserves a shout out, definitely. I mean, Ted, probably more than anybody else, yours truly included, has done more to bring about the manipulation moniker than anybody other than GATA, but Ted particularly on the silver side. And, you know, these people have been chastised by the establishment types for decades, really, for a very, very long time. And yet here you finally have in writing, admitting and paying a fine that, yes, the silver market's manipulated, not only by Deutsche Bank, but many others. And, of course, if you look at some of the email exchanges, it's really, it's funny and it's sad. You know, we're going to smash them down and ha, 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 and they're laughing at each other by email and how powerful they are and when they're going to do it and how they're going to profit. It's really sick, but that's the real world that we live in. So that's number one. So that could change the psychology, especially to some big players that know how the system is geared and know how to, let's say, work the system. I mean, I've already had a couple of white papers that are very exclusive on how to basically, I won't say corner the silver market, I don't want to get myself in trouble, but let's say you could, within legal means, nothing, totally above board, put more pressure on particularly silver. We could do it in gold as well, and of course platinum, palladium go unsaid or such small markets. But this technique is totally legal, and it really puts a lot of heat on the paper markets. But regardless of that, the other part is one that came from one of my long-term website members, and he wrote me twice about, do I think that, and I'm not going to name the names, but they're prominent people in the precious metals world that are, let's say, have been associated with Trump in the past. So if you're aware of that statement, you could probably connect the dots of who it is. Do you think that they will come forward and talk to Trump about the metals manipulation and have an impact into stopping this? And I wrote him back and said, I don't think so, but I certainly don't know so. And, you know, so, but the idea is still coming full circle and being a little more succinct. Yes, we have shifted, I think, the psychology of the metals markets to where now all these non-believers about, oh, there's no manipulation, they have to admit that there is. And two, now it's a question of, well, if it's manipulated, I'm going to stay out of it. When you realize that actually the manipulation has given you a great gift, you're buying something at a cost that basically is the cost of production. Anytime you can buy any commodity under the cost of production or at the cost of production, have some patience, you're going to do quite well. Mm-hmm. And lastly, on the side of silver, I mean, it's such a small market relative to the gold market. If going back to November of last year, the Silver and Gold Summit was held in San Francisco for the second year in a row, and Jeff Christian did a presentation that was, from my opinion, one of the best he's done. It was very interesting because Jeff's more establishment than me. I think anyone that's seen both of us realizes that. We have different world views. But nonetheless, he has pretty good data, and I consider him to be fairly accurate on his numbers. Again, we don't philosophically agree on everything, but I don't agree philosophically with everybody, with anyone anyway. So back on point, he said that if you took all of the assets that are financial assets and excluded real estate, so take all the, you know, apartments and warehouses and hotels and all the commercial real estate out of the equation, all the residential real estate out of the equation, and all you have left are the bond market, the stock market, the options markets, and the futures markets, that gold represents 1% of all those assets. So if you included real estate, it'd be far less than that. So 1% of all liquid financial assets is the gold market. But here's the killer, and I couldn't believe it. In fact, I was in the audience, as I just said, and I made him verify because it knocked me over. Silver is 0.02% of that equation.
Wow.
So I've always said that if you got doubling in the gold buyers from 1% of the world's population to 2% of the population, you probably couldn't peg a paper price on gold. You know, it'd be 5,000, 10,000, 15, who knows? But if you doubled the demand for physical gold, certainly I'd probably take out the paper players. But in silver, think about it. If it's only 0.02% of the world's assets, you could go up 10 times and get to 0.2% of the world's assets in the silver market. And I think it will definitely do something like that. I don't want to stick my neck out on the number, but I want the idea to be clear to people. So as gold starts to accelerate more and more, and people worry about if their pension will be there, if their municipality is going to fail, that the XYZ county's bonds are going to be able to pay off, their Social Security comes in, but it's only paying for the light bill. It doesn't pay for gas, food, and their lights anymore. All these things that are going to converge at the same time, or roughly the same time, is going to cause a run to gold like you've never seen in the history of mankind. Mm. And when that takes place, gold will start getting priced in dollars outside of the purview of most people to achieve even buying an ounce of gold. But they'll spill over into its poor man's gold, silver, and you'll see a rush in the silver. Well, think about the dynamics of that. If there's like that extra 1% that can afford gold and goes into the gold market and pushes the price up substantially, think for every one of those, how many are there? Are there 10 other people that have something to protect that'll run in the silver market? So you can see quite easily once this final phase of this bull market takes off, that there'll be a huge number of people that'll run into the silver market because that's the only thing that they can do to protect themselves.
You know, going back to manipulation exposure, Trump does not seem to be concerned about ruffling feathers. And we've seen that the way he tweets. I mean, just the way he communicates with the world. He is not afraid to butt heads. And I mean, as you were talking about that, man, he could be the one to just start saying things on Twitter about the monetary system and cause a major rush to precious metals, you know, just from him going off on a tangent, going off on a derivative. I don't know if the establishment would be able to control that if he did cause and spur a panic in the market like that. But moving on, David, before the call, you were telling me about a new opportunity in a unique sector, and you're going to be telling everyone and sharing this with all of your premium members. And I've been a member of the Morgan Report for some time now, and I know you do your research and you look and search for deep discounted value to invest in. And I give us a little teaser here of what you will be sharing with your audience here going forward.
Well, it's a unique situation, and it's happened to us, I think twice before, where one of our speculative companies spins off another company at a tax-free basis. We did it with a company called Prophecy Coal that's now named Prophecy Development, and they had the Wellgreen property, which is a PGM, a platinum group metal property. It's pretty good. Some of our staff have gone up there, toured it, and we wrote a big report on it. So this was spun off to shareholders of Prophecy as a freebie, more or less, meaning that if you held shares. So we have an opportunity like that again in another one of our speculations. And I can't give too much information. Not only do I, you know, would like to get more, you know, website members, and that's obviously part of this. I mean, I'll be honest about that part. The other part is, by law, I'm not allowed to say very much because it has to be disclosed in the public domain. I can put it privately because we've already written about the parent company and we've got information from the parent company about the spinout, but it has to be voted on. I mean, it could possibly not take place, but I'm convinced it will. And there's like a 2-month window. According to the latest information that could change, we have January and February before this vote gets tallied and this spin out takes place. But it's a very interesting situation where you're mining above ground gold, which means e-waste, which is short for electronic waste. And I've been telling people, because this is what I was told, and now I have better numbers, that some of the marginal gold mines out there mine 1 gram of gold per ton, and that smartphones have about 3 grams of gold per ton. Well, actually, it's greater than that. And there's parts of computer waste or electronic waste that are far superior to the amount of gold per ton than a smartphone. And so this is an area that is being utilized now. I mean, there's a lot of electronic waste recycling. However, the idea or the situation that we have is a new reagent that actually precipitates out the metals rapidly and environmentally as friendly as it can possibly be. In other words, the reagent is basically inert. It's you could drink it and not harm yourself. So this is a huge breakthrough. I mean, I'm going to digress a bit and I'll try to be fast, Kenneth. I know we're going a fairly long time, but you know, Jerome Smith was the silver guru back in the last bull market, and he said, you know, silver's going to go to $200 an ounce by 1990 or something like that. And I was at an investment conference, and the promoter said, you know, Dave, we've been hearing about this silver deficit forever, and it never happens. And, you know, now we're in the 2000s, and, you know, silver's sitting here at, you know, $7 or whatever it was at the time, which is very low at the time. And, you know, what happened? I said, well, what happened was there was a huge shift in the mining industry about the time that he wrote his last book. And what he didn't realize is the technological change. And the technological change at that time, as bizarre as it sounds now, Kenneth, was cyanide, heap leaching. Wow. And that has a huge, massive increase in the amount of metal production, precious metals production, ever before. And it's a pretty archaic system. I mean, basically, you put up a big pile of concentrate, and you pour cyanide over it. I mean, that's the quick and dirty version of it. So it changed rapidly, and so there was a lot big increase in the amount of production, which he had never, accounted for or thought about. And that's why if the data continued on the linear path that he had projected, he was right. Silver would have hit $200 probably, or something like that, in the mid 90s. But there was this big shift in technology. So I never forgot that lesson. So this is another one where it's a potentially big shift in technology that will have a huge impact on how electronics waste is processed and the way the company is speaking right now. And again, I hope I don't get myself in trouble, but I guess I could say, and it's verbal, it's been indicated to me that it will be on a licensing agreement, which I think is a really, really good way to do it. You know, if you get a little piece of the pie every time it's used, like a record album, wow. So I'm real, real excited about it. Again, it's still speculative, highly speculative, but it's one of those, you know, like Voisey Bay. I mean, this is one of those situations, in my opinion, that if you have it early on, you don't have to get in the Morgan Report right now to get in on the inside track. You can wait, and it might be smarter to wait and make sure the company develops. But it'd be one that you really want to learn about fairly early and have some patience. These things usually take 3 to 5 years to come to maturity, but this could be, you know, 10-bagger, 20-bagger, 100-bagger, 1,000-bagger. I don't know. The potential in e-waste is humongous, and you know that because I sent you the data to look at.
Mm-hmm. And if anyone wants to get the details on that, we'll have the link in the description area and also on your screen. Incredible value that you'll receive when subscribing to the Morgan Report. David, two more topics before we close here. I know we're going a little longer today, but I wanted to get your thoughts as to where we are. You know, if you've taken a look at the COT numbers, you know, where do you think we're headed with precious metals here going into 2017? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I do the premium service, as you know, you're a member. These days, it's about a weekly update verbally. I look at charts or not, but most of the time I do. And I've gotten in the habit of looking at the commitment of traders a little more often. And I really don't want to get in the habit of doing it every week. And the reason for that is that, as important as the commitment of traders is, it's not the end-all, be-all, only way to trade, only way to know when a bottom's in. It certainly is important. But having said that, it looks as if we're close enough to a bottom for the metals to start coming up. Obviously, they have for 2 days in a row. And it's a moving target, because what used to be pretty much a lead pipe cinch, this is absolutely it number, changes. And it's changed because there's more interest in the precious metals on the paper and physical side than there's ever been. But, and I'm not saying we're at all-time high purchasing of physical metals, although it's a much more robust market than the price would indicate. Coming back, the open interest continues to rise. So it's not something that I will know exactly when we hit the bottom. And I say that to say this, there was a time before the ETFs where you could know almost to the penny when you had hit the exact number of the commercials versus the trading funds. And when you hit that number, you knew that from that day, you were probably gonna go higher. That luxury left us a long, long time ago. So you have to use the numbers and some intuition and some experience to kind of game it and figure out, okay, are we or aren't we? And having done the last one, I think a couple of weeks ago, I said I'd like to see it better. I'd like the numbers to be more like this, but they're close enough to a bottom to say, yeah, it could be a bottom. So I have a hunch we're going to get the typical January, February, March rally. And then I'm going to have to take a look. And of course, I always let the market dictate my thinking, just like Richard Russell, and I'm not putting myself in the same class as him, although I'd like to achieve that at some point. But I do listen to the market quite carefully. And the market usually can tip its hand if you know where to look. And so I will be watching the COT carefully to see, you know, if this thing zooms up and all of a sudden the professionals are shorting the heck out of this market and the COT goes up quite a bit on the commercial side shorting. I will be giving a caution to the website members.
And David, before we close here, you are a health guru. Many people know that. I'd like to get a tip from you. If you were to give, you know, a tip or two as to how to start your day, or, you know, how to have more energy and just be efficient, what would your tips be for the audience here?
Well, this could go for an hour, but I'll be succinct. Number one, I think, is, you know, mental. I think number one that I was taught by a good friend, and, you know, start off your day with gratitude. You know, when you rise up in the morning, think of what a precious privilege it is just to be alive, to breathe, to think, to enjoy, and to love. I mean, that's something that I think is number one. And number two, I've really started experimenting a couple years ago. I adhere to a lot of these guys. Ben Greenfield used to coach me when I did triathlons, and I haven't done them in years, folks. Dave Asprey from the Bulletproof Coffee guy. And I know these guys personally, not like they're my best friends, but, you know, I know them. I've physically been with them, type of thing. Anyway, intermittent fasting, IF it's called, intermittent fasting. I am convinced as you get older, and I'll be 64 here in the end of this month, is a very good way to reset the system. And so I'm not going to lecture you on intermittent fasting. I think it's something that is definitely benefited me, and I think it's something that is worthwhile for most people to look into and see if you want to experiment with it.
Yeah, well, definitely. And even the simple fact of, hey, you've overeaten for a few days, let's cut back on some calories. That kind of makes sense for just balancing out your body's intake of food and energy, or over intake of food and energy. I find myself never really in that good state of balance, or I fight myself, at least, not being in that state of, I'm either overeating or under eating, and I always have a hard time of balancing. And I think, you know, going through that cleansing stage, you know, of fasting is definitely a huge benefit. And I've been pounding pomegranates, pounding blackberries, pounding blueberries, and even doing lemon water in the morning. I find that to be extremely refreshing as well. David Morgan, everyone of the Morgan Report. David, any closing thoughts you have before we say goodbye here?
A couple things. Get on our free email list. You can go to themorganreport.com. Currently, we're giving you a webinar called Is There a Silver Shortage? I think this is important for you to know the actual facts. You can get that. And if you haven't already gotten the Riches and Resources Report, go to our other domain, which is richesinresources.com, and you can get that report as well. So two things to look for free. Try to educate as many people that are interested in the precious metals and the resource sector. richesinresources.com. Get that free report, get two movies and a lot of free information about resources and how to invest in them. And the other one is the free webinar, which is called Is There a Silver Shortage?
Well, David, again, I'm so appreciative of you coming on the show with me today and sharing your thoughts and wisdom on the markets and health. So thanks so much.
My pleasure. Thank you. This good feeling, the Dow's going to go over 20,000. You know, the metals, commodities look good. If you looked at the news feeds yesterday, and I certainly can't read them all, but I looked at your Reuters and BMO, and both of them were positive. They're looking positively for the economy. China came out with numbers that indicated that they're doing better than they have in quite some time. That kind of gave the whole market a lift. And the commodity sector and both these mainstream financial channels talked about stronger commodity markets. You look at the other white metals, platinum, palladium, and they both had two really strong days at the beginning of this year. Obviously, we're just a few days in. And that's a trade I used to make almost every year. I didn't do it this year, and I'm kind of mad at myself. Palladium is such a thin market, but both of the white metals usually get a pretty good run into January. And so far, so good. As we're doing the interview, Kenneth, we're looking at everybody's up, gold, silver, platinum, and palladium. Those first three are up less than 1%, and palladium is up about 4.5%. Anyway, the point I'm making is that most of the mainstream is looking for a more positive outlook across the board, commodities, stocks. Not much is said about the bond market. I finally am convinced that the top of the bond market is in, and we're going to see higher interest rates and lower bond prices from here on out for quite some time.
What is that? And that was actually one of the questions I had for you, is interest rates. And if interest rates go up to a certain degree, at what point does it compete with stocks and put major downward pressure on the overall stock market?
Yeah, that's actually an easy question to answer if you understand, you know, the dynamics of interest rates. So if, you know, one of the big bugaboos out there that's misunderstood by a lot of people is, you know, higher interest rates are bad for gold. Higher real interest rates are bad for gold. So let me illustrate. If you go back to the major upleg in gold and silver, 1979 through January 1980, what you saw was the published CPI was at 13% inflation. Mm. So when Volcker put interest rates to like 20%, that was a real rate of 7%. Why? Because 20 minus the 13 that the government admitted gives you 7. So you have 7% real interest rates. That's what you're really getting, because 13% of that 20% is eaten up by inflation. So until you get to a positive real interest rate, it has no effect on gold. In fact, gold goes up as interest rates come up until it hits that point or beyond that point where you get a real return. So that's something that most people just don't understand, because most people really don't get what inflation means and how insidious it is. You know, it's in fact, some people, even in, I wouldn't say that they're true Austrians, but the Austrian
establishment is in disarray. We're seeing that right now. Democrats, at least, are frantically trying to come up with some reason to disparage the Trump victory. And they keep coming up short. You know, Julian Assange, in a major interview with Sean Hannity, has denied having any contacts with Russian sources. And of course, you know, we had the recount, the Electoral College. You know, it's the fault of the Electoral College for why Donald Trump became elected, you know, the Russian hacking. And then, you know, if we go back earlier this year, you know, Brexit and so forth. So the establishment is really losing ground here. And I want to get your thoughts on that and then actually transition to the metals. I mean, are we going to see a loss of control that the establishment has over the metals going forward here?
Okay, well, you gave me two questions. On the first one, you know, what's going on with, you know, blaming Russia for everything. I mean, really, it's, you know, I'll just spit it out because, you know, I can be fairly aggressive at times. If you really, I've thought about it. Here's my thoughts. Look, we've got the NSA, right? Well, the National Security Association or Advisory, whatever it's called, the NSA, the big spy agency, basically listens to every frickin' phone call, every email. In other words, they gather in electronic intelligence, communications intelligence, and signal intelligence across the globe. Purportedly, they get every frickin' piece of information that exists. Now, they're the establishment. So if they really were on top of their game and we had an honest political class, they'd come right out and say, hey, we're the NSA and here's where it came from. They know. They get all the info.
That's right.
But do they come out and say, oh, we're the NSA, and it came directly from here. It was leaked by an insider at the CIA to WikiLeaks. He is no longer in our club. He's been booted out, and we're after him, or whatever. I mean, I made up that part just to get you to think. But, I mean, the NSA could easily come out and say, well, it came from here. They know. But do they say anything? Oh, no, 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 no. They're in the background. So now they're out there. Actually, they're trying, you know, in my view, manipulate. Again, psychology, public opinion, what really drives everything. And people are emotional beings. I mean, you know, we use an intellect, but people aren't taught logic. They're not taught critical thinking. They're not taught to really evaluate things objectively. And we all have our biases. I'll admit most of mine, at least I can, the ones I can see. And this is the problem that, you know, oh, it didn't feel good or it doesn't feel right. Well, you know what? We have a plethora of emotions and you got to deal with all of them in an adult way once you reach adulthood, which is an achievement that very few in this country achieve, in my opinion. So back to the second question on the medals.
Well, before we'll get to that in a second here. Sure. So on that, I actually heard, you know, and I was thinking about this. Hillary Clinton spent $1.5-2 billion on her campaign. But going back to the fact that they're in such disarray, I mean, they thought they
persuasion thing. Well, you know, 2% inflation is okay. No. You don't want any inflation. In fact, in a stable monetary system where you have an honest-based system, at least this is what the past shows us, you get a gentle deflation, which is not bad. And this is actually how the markets really work, which means that your iPhone 7 is better than your iPhone 5, and it costs you less. That's an increase in productivity. It's an increase of the product itself. And it's deflationary because it costs you less in U.S. dollars or Federal Reserve notes than it did, let's say, 5 years earlier.
Sure.
And that's a general trend because human nature and the markets itself generally improve. And they squeeze the margin, meaning they give you a better product at a lower cost. So if you have a stable monetary system, you actually have a higher standard of living generally year over year. And that's what, you know, we all want. We all want to have, you know, a high lifestyle. And those, that, you know, concept means different things to different people. And I think we can talk about that at the end of the show. But so that's the idea. It's a real interest rate. That's sure. What you have to be with.
Well, and to be fair, a lot of the inflation that we've seen has been exported overseas. And the other countries have experienced the brunt end of U.S. inflation. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, we export a lot of entertainment, you know, movies, Hollywood and others. And then we export inflation through the U.S. dollar being the reserve currency of the world. And we have a great war machine. So, I mean, we export a lot of debt and death. And I mean, I hate to be so blunt, but if you really are objective and you're really truthful with yourself and you look out and see what really is rather than what you want it to be, what you see is this death and debt paradigm that Chris Duane talks about all the time, and he's right. This is really the exports, and this is a very sad state of affairs. What we really want is what the liberals always talk about. You know, we want to respect everyone, you know, be tolerant, and we want diversity. Well, there's no better diversity than having a nation state have its own culture. I mean, this idea that we need a new world order and we put everybody in a blender and we stir it up and everybody comes out the same. I mean, how boring is that? I mean, it's much more interesting world to have, you know, nation states that have their own culture, or within those states have a culture. And so, you know, that's my perspective. You don't have to agree with it, but I kind of like to flip it back on the liberals, what's called liberals today, because, you know, if you really want diversity, then leave these, then let's not have a new world order. Let's let people be themselves. Let's let them determine their own future. Let's let them have their own culture. Let's let them have their own monetary system if they care to. But the reality is that the biggest problems in the war effort, I'll call it, has to do primarily with resources and not fitting into the Anglo-American Empire's banking system.
Well, speaking of the establishment, and you know, let's talk about the outsider coming in here for a brief moment. The establishment were going to win. If they thought they were going to lose, I mean, maybe they would have spent a lot more money. And, you know, and we didn't see that, though. And that's where, to me, it seems like there's just a dysfunction in the establishment, and the fact that we saw Donald Trump rise up. I mean, it's so powerful, regardless of, you know, you fully support him or whatever. The fact, what he means to this, the current situation is very powerful, in that the sources such as WikiLeaks and the internet are really making it very difficult for the establishment to do what they do. Even Bitcoin. I mean, the Bitcoin rise, an unmanipulated free market currency doing what it's doing is making a huge statement right now. And I don't know what the world is going to look like in 5-10 years. And I just think changes are happening so fast.
Absolutely. I mean, the internet is more powerful than the Gutenberg press, in my opinion. I said that very early on when the internet became more available to the average person. And that's been a long time ago. And this free market of ideas is extremely profound. And nothing is more profound than the truth spoken at the right time, which is basically what Trump did. I'm not a big Trump thumper, believe me. But the establishment had such a difficult time packaging something that was so inconsistent, that was flip-flopping, would say something at one rally and something contradictory to that at another rally, trying to be something, no consistency, no truth, no credibility, and all those things played into, you know, so the establishment had a very hard time packaging that. And on the other side, you had basically an independent. You had somebody that was not really beholden to the political class at all. And they came up, and yeah, they shot off the cuff, and yeah, they probably said things that upset people, but at least you knew you were getting something sincere, something truthful, or at least it came across that way. Again, we're going back to perception and emotion and how people felt about it. Mm-hmm. But it resonated with enough people that a lot of people got off their butts and never voted in a long time and got out there and voted. Mm-hmm. So this is something that resonates with people. You know, the time has come to speak the truth clearly and precisely. And the truth is, we're broke. Most other nations are broke. And we got a real mess on our hands on a physical economy basis because we're producing stuff, but not enough of what we really need. And the flow rate, the velocity of money has come to a very low ebb. And there is one way to get it going again, and that's fiscal policy, which Trump will implement, which means direct government payment into the back pockets of the workers, the workers that are working on government programs, which means fixing the infrastructure. That won't fix the problem, but it will fix the psychology for a while. Excuse me. So you'll see a kind of a Trump euphoria. I think that could last, you know, anywhere from 6 months to a year and a half. I don't want to go a year and a half. But the reality of the big monster in the background of the debt pyramid is still there. And and then we export inflation through the U.S. dollar being the reserve currency of the world, and we have a great war machine. So, I mean, we export a lot of debt and death.
A new silver company for investors, with Keith Neumeyer agreeing to become a major shareholder. Luke Norman, co-founder of Gold Standard Ventures, is the new chairman, and the company has acquired three former First Majestic silver properties. To learn more about this must-own silver stock, go to futuremoneytrends.com/silver1. That's futuremoneytrends.com/silver1.
Hello, everyone, and welcome into CrushTheStreet.com. I'm Kenneth Amaduri, and I'm joined today with David Morgan of TheMorganReport.com. I've known David now for a number of years, going back to, you know, my early days in the newsletter world. I really looked up to him. I still do. And, you know, I'm very honored to be speaking with him today, especially at the start of this year, to get his thoughts on what are going on in the metals and the market as a whole. And, you know, he was one of the ones that suspected, you know, precious metals to turn down after a really spectacular start in 2016 in the summer. He was suspecting that we would see the pullback. And here we are. You know, metals have pulled down, and they're starting to trend up here, having a good little start to 2017. But I want to get his thoughts on that. And he's got an interesting, very interesting speculation play for all of his members that we're going to hear a little bit about towards the end of this interview. But first of all, David, thanks for joining me today.
Well, thank you for the kind words and the introduction. I hope I can live up to it.
You always do, sir. You know, 2017 has not started off in the panic the way 2016 did. You know, if you recall, we had the interest rate hike and the news from China, markets melting down across the world. It seems like there's a little more optimism in the air. Precious metals are up, so is oil, and the Dow Jones once again, you know, on the verge of breaking 20,000. What do you make of this?
Well, it's a shift in psychology, really. I mean, if you know, as much as I study the stock market and continue to and study all markets, and you know, one of the biggest errors I made as a very young guy was, you know, having a strong math background and relying too much on numbers, you know, and I'm still a numbers guy. I mean, I want to make sure that, you know, the investments that we put in the Morgan Report are, you know, especially in the top and mid tier, you know, make sense numerically. However, the markets are really psychological, and it has a lot to do with how people feel. And So the feeling is now, basis Trump or not, the market is signaling, and there's different whys. I think one of the big whys is because Trump is elected, but I think there's other reasons, and they play into the